What isn't nice to see, though, is that we are not as fit and active as we like to imagine we are. That's according to a new World Health Organization report, which paints a really damning picture of Kiwis' physical activity. It's the organization's first ever report on world global exercise habits, and Aotearoa does not rate well. According to the report, 95% of girls aged 11 to 17 are physically inactive. It's slightly less for boys at 85%. Kiwi kids are below the global average of 81% as well. As for adults, the numbers aren't much better. It says 45% of women are inactive and 39% of men don't work out enough. Those stats worsen again as we get older, with 62% of women and 55% of men over the age of 70 not exercising enough. Again, our stats do not look good next to the global average for adults, with a much lower 21% who are not active enough. Stats collected here in Aotearoa by the likes of Sports New Zealand paint a slightly better picture, but it's still not good. So for more on why we're seeing this and what we can do to make it better, we're joined by Exercise New Zealand's Richard Beddie alongside Hadley Poesi, a youth worker here at Zeal New Zealand. Morena, you two. Thank you so much for being with us. We so appreciate it.
Oh, good morning.
Hadley, I'm going to come to you very shortly, but Richard, I wanted to start with you. This does not sound good. I'm not happy about hearing this, and I'm sure you're not either.
Yeah, look, a lot of people are shocked by these statistics, and I think the sort of illusion I think we have in New Zealand is that we're a sporting nation, and you know, we know that on the sports field we actually have some great talent, and whether it's the All Blacks or Team New Zealand, or at the moment obviously with the World Cup here, which is fantastic for women, but the problem is that generally does not translate into participation, and elite sport and participation are not as linked as people would think, and I think this fixation with sport is part of the problem, because sport is part of the solution to physical activity, but it's not the only part. And there are two other important bits, one of which is what we call incidental activity. So that's cycling to work, or in the case of, walking to school, cycling to school. But also there's structured exercise. And of course, that's the fastest growing part. So that's going to the gym, going to a class, doing a boot camp on the beach, doing a community class. And that's the kind of activity that's actually growing a lot faster. So sport has its role to play, but it's not the long-term solution. It's a mix of things that we need to focus on.
You'll see this as well, Hadley, I'm sure, because I think of myself as a kid and sport just didn't click with me. I didn't find the thing that I was good at, and so I didn't really do anything, because for me, I only associated physical activity with rugby or cricket or netball or whatever it is the kids at school were doing.
Yeah.
So because I never found my thing, that definitely flowed on into my adult life as well in terms of a lack of exercise. Do you see that as well with the kids that you're looking after?
Yeah, I think there's a couple of different things. Number one, like, we're having to teach kids how to play now. The trying to get kids physically active, you're competing against their devices now, and so at such a young age, they're not understanding the enjoyment of just being physically active. It goes straight to competition, and as soon as you go to competition, a lot of young people just stare clear away from that. They don't want to be a part of that, but they never got the opportunity nowadays anyway. They never got the opportunity to find out the fun that can be had through physical activity.
It's bad for our girls, Richard, as well. I was reading some of the stats, and I mentioned them in the introduction. 95% of our girls between 11 and 17 are physically inactive. How serious is that as a statistic?
It's a really major problem. So if you're looking at a school level, it actually impacts academic performance. The best thing you can do for a young Tamariki is to actually get them physically active. It actually improves academic performance. There's some fascinating research from the US where one of the lowest performing schools globally, all they did was remove the first class of the day, did physical activity, and then improved academic performance across the board. And you raise a really good point about your background in terms of, you consider yourself a sporty kid, and as a result, were turned off all physical activity. And funnily enough, that's exactly my story. I went to an all-boys school in Christchurch, and so the choice was rugby or not. And the reality is, I didn't like rugby. I got a note from my mum. I mean, I say that not proudly, just it was an observation. I didn't like it. But I consider myself an inactive person because I didn't relate to sport, and particularly to rugby. And there's nothing wrong with rugby. Rugby's awesome. It's our national game. But the problem is that only works for a percentage of our Tamariki. And the same with adults. I mean, this idea of playing, this enjoying what we do with physical activity is so important, not doing the thing that is a chore, because the reality is we'll do that for a short period. We need to focus on things that we can enjoy, and whether that is rugby or netball or going to the gym or yoga, the activities that we can do, and some of them are not competitive, and that's really important.
It's that link, right? And I think a lot of people see physical activity as you say, Richard, a chore, the thing that they have to do, but the thing that they hate to do, which is not a good mentality to be in.
Absolutely. If you ask anyone that goes to the gym, you'll find that they love it. They generally say, I like to go. And it's like, well, how do you find the time? It's like, well, I want to find the time. Mm. And that, again, for most people who are not active, don't understand that that would be a thing. But again, it's because once you start to do it, you feel better about yourself. And it's not just a body transformation, but it's as much a mind transformation. And whether that is gym or yoga class, whatever the activity is, and it's about finding that thing that you enjoy, or in some cases, refinding it. Because most people are active at some point in their life. It's matter of finding what that is. And for children, of course, play is so important. It shouldn't be a structured thing, but if it needs to be, so be it, because whatever it takes to get our people active, because this isn't just about them at this stage, it's also about long-term health costs. We're spending a couple of $1 billion a year completely unnecessarily on health costs, which we could avoid and spend on things that matter. So whether that's cancer treatment or maybe reinvesting into education, you know, at the moment we have a problem with not enough money in New Zealand. We want to reduce the burden on the taxpayer for things that are just completely unnecessary. And physical activity is resulting in billions of dollars to the taxpayer.
So how do you find the joy, Hadley? I bet that must be a big challenge for you guys in terms of finding the things that these kids actually want to be involved in.
Yeah, well, you know, for us, we like to teach a lot of unstructured play. We like to teach sports and take the rules away so that there's a sense of just creativity, imagination, and take the competitive side of it away so they can just enjoy the social aspect of being physically active with one another. Also the idea of what physical activity is. You know, we teach hundreds of young people dance, and there's so many young people that love to get moving to music, and you know, that even translates to our older people as well. And so people's idea of that being a physical activity or a sport, it gets you going, you know, it gets the body moving, it gets the heart rate up, but a lot of times we only think about sports as physical activity.
Yep.
There's a whole lot of different activities and things that we can do to get our young people physically active.
And I think about what the kids are into, right?
Yeah.
Things like TikTok.
Look at TikTok.
Jenny May and I found it last year. You dance on TikTok and you go viral, right?
Yeah, yeah.
So it's about relating it to what the kids are liking, what the kids are talking about, doing, and finding the ways to make them enjoy what it is that they should be doing.
That's it. You have to make it relevant. You have to make it something that they want to spend their time on. And unfortunately, again, they're battling, you're competing against their devices, you're competing against the TikToks to try and get their attention. And so why not try and merge those two worlds? For us, we've found that dance does that really well.
And do you find the flow-on effect? If kids are being active and they're enjoying play and they're being involved in sports or whatever, do you find the flow-on effect to the rest of their, you know, their
life?
For sure.
The big thing is confidence.
Yep.
You know, if a young person can hold themselves well physically, they're confident in every other area of life.
Richard, do you understand, we talked about those statistics in the introduction, and our girls are particularly bad when it comes to physical inactivity. Do we know why? Is there a correlation between why our girls might not be clicking, it might not be clicking for them?
Well, if you want to make some generalisation, it's fair to say that girls and women in generally are more collaborative rather than competitive. And if you think again, we go back to what we talked about sport before, sport is naturally competitive, which for some younger Tamariki just doesn't resonate. And you generally find, particularly with younger women, is that they'll drop off together. So if their friends are not active, they're not active. Whereas with boys, some of their friends can be active and some of their friends can be inactive, and that's okay, they'll still carry on. Some of them will play sports, some of them won't. And so this is about, again, a lot of it is about sport drop-off. So they're playing netball, they don't play netball anymore, and therefore they do nothing. And what we need to make sure that we're doing, and this is really, you know, central, is making sure there are options. So sport is part of the solution, and I keep going back to it. I think we overfixate with the idea that sport is activity. It's a form of activity, and we need to continue with sports and offer them, and of course offer more sports. And so whether that's skateboarding, whether that's wakaama, you know, less rowing, more wakaama would be a good idea in many schools around New Zealand. But of course, that's not always feasible because that's quite expensive, right? So it's finding the activities that people can relate to, people can enjoy, and it's also okay that kids start something and stop it. Because as long as they have this love for moving their body, it doesn't matter what activity they're doing, rather than saying you need to do this for an extended period. You just need to do something. Play is so important for younger children, and then finding a thing that they love for the long term.
Hadley, how do you think we get this right?
I think we just got to make it fun again.
Yeah.
Yeah. We got to give young people an opportunity to play at a young age, you know. Maybe don't give the devices so early. Get out there to your local parks, get out there to your local playgrounds. Families getting amongst it as a family activity as well.
Because, Richard, you touched on it, the cost. Deloitte says about $2.3 billion in lost productivity because of physical inactivity. It's been estimated that physical inactivity causes 6 to 10% of the cases of premature mortality. So this is really serious if we don't get this right.
It is, absolutely. And in fact, if you look at the top five killers across every age group, across every gender and across every ethnicity, they are improved by physical activity. So we're talking cancer, heart disease, stroke. In some age groups, we're talking about suicide. All of them are improved by physical activity. And this is the thing. It literally is the magic pill. And again, I try not to get preachy about this because I understand that, you know, approximately half of Kiwis aren't active enough. This isn't about telling people off when they're doing a bad job. It's about saying, let's work together to help people. In some cases, it's, yes, you need to make the decision yourself to go and do this. But in other cases, it's about supporting people because you've got solo parents and they're at home from school when they've got one young child and one older child. It's really hard to drop them off to play a sport. But it's about finding the things that we can work together as a community, and this is where government has its role to play. So in some cases it is about funding. It's not always about funding. For many people it's not. It's about making the choices ourselves, but it is about community, it's about government, and of course it's about us collectively working together to actually make this enjoyable for everybody, because it's easy to describe, it's somewhat harder to do, because we're talking about human behaviour change, which is complex.
You two have been so fantastic, and like you say, Richard, it is a complex conversation, but one that we've got to have. So thank you so much for coming in and having it with
us. No worries.
That's Hadley Poesi from Zeal Education Trust and Richard Beddie from Exercise New Zealand. Really appreciate your time.
All good.